right, good afternoon, everyone. I'm pleased to welcome everyone here today. My name is Dr. Philip Phillips, and I'm the Associate Dean of the University Honors College. So on behalf of the Honors College and Dr. John Weil, our Dean, I welcome you to the Honors Lecture Series on Rhetoric and Contemporary Culture. I mentioned before that this is a class and that it's also an event that is open to the public. I would like to make a special welcome to all of you who are here for the Honors Open House event. How many of you are here for that? I see several of you in the audience. That's great, and I met some of you today. I'm glad that you came because this lecture series is an essential part of the Honors curriculum. So welcome today. Our speaker today is Keel Hunt. Keel Hunt is a graduate of Nashville Public Schools and of Middle Tennessee State University. He received his master's degree from the Medill School of Journalism at Northwestern University and attended the senior executive program of the Kennedy School of Government at Harvard. In his early career, Keel was an editorial writer, Washington correspondent, and city editor of the Tennessean. In 1974, the Tennessee affiliate of the National Wildlife Federation named Keel Conservation Communicator of the Year for his investigative journalism, including coverage of the Tennessee Valley Authority, and his reporting that sparked the campaign that saved Nashville's Radnor Lake from private development. In 1977 to 78, Keel was research director and speechwriter for Lamar Alexander in his successful race for governor of Tennessee. He was appointed special assistant to Governor Alexander, serving as the coordinator of the governor's policy group and executive director of the state planning office. Keel left the governor's staff in 1986 to become a public affairs consultant. His firm, the Strategy Group, has served some of Tennessee's largest enterprises, from HCA, Ingram Industries, and First Tennessee Bank, to Bell South and AT&T, to Meharry Medical College, Vanderbilt, MTSU, and Lipscomb Universities. In 1992 to 93, Keel was president of the Leadership Nashville Alumni Association and organized Nashville's Agenda. This was the citywide visioning process updated in 2007 that involved thousands of Nashvillians and generated initiatives ranging from the Frist Center for the Visual Arts to Nashville Housing Fund. Keel has been involved in the planning of some of Middle Tennessee's highest profile projects, the Country Music Hall of Fame and Museum, the Frist Center, the Plan of Nashville, Skirmerhorn Symphony Center, the forthcoming African American Music Museum in Nashville, the Tennessee Miller Coliseum in Murfreesboro, and Lipscomb's McAdams Athletic Center. Keel is a trustee of the Country Music Foundation, and he's a member of the Board of Visitors for our very own Honors College here at MTSU. He's the author of Coup, The Day the Democrats Ousted Their Governor, published in 2013 by Vanderbilt University Press, The Story of the Ouster of Tennessee Governor Ray Blanton in 1979. In his spare time, he writes a regular column called Metropolitan for the Tennessean editorial pages. Keel and his wife Marcia have two adult children and three grandchildren. And the topic of his presentation today is Political Speech, How Candidates Win and Leaders Lead. Please join me in welcoming Keel Hunt.
Thank you.
Thank you, Philip. John, is this on? Okay. You think I have no notes, right? No net. Okay. No, I have notes, seriously. I've thought about this, and it's really an honor to be here. I appreciate Philip inviting me down, Dean John Weil being here, Dean Ken Paulson, my friend, being here, and all of you. I might say two things first. One is that the term, okay, Philip read all that great stuff, right, and you're impressed. That's great. But I got to tell you, the word lecture is kind of intimidating to me, you know, and I'd rather this be not so much a lecture as a conversation. And by which I mean anytime you want to, you know, interrupt me with a question, I hope you will. And I hope we have a good time in this next few minutes. Just to add a little color in between the lines of what Philip kindly read, I was in college here. I won't tell you what year, but it was in the late Jurassic period, approximately, and it was after we had that whole movable type thing, okay? So if you can figure that out, yeah. That's when I was here. I grew up in Nashville. MTSU was then and has been ever since a very important part of my life, my career. I felt I grew up here. I learned a lot here. I was an English major. Another kind of time frame definitional fact is that I was in school here before there was a Department of Journalism. That was a while. And I mentioned that just to say that during my freshman year, I was working, as many of us do and must, I was working nights and weekends in Nashville at the Tennessean newspaper, which was a real turning point for me and in my life and career also. I was also editor of the Sidelines. Anybody here write for the Sidelines? No? Okay. The Sidelines. We still have the Sidelines, right? Okay. And so, you know, stirred up my share of trouble while I was there. The office was actually at that point on the opposite side of campus. But I was also working nights and weekends at the Tennessean newspaper. They would have the starters, you know, the cub reporters, do some basic things to get oriented. One of them was to cover the police beat, you know. Nights. It was morning newspapers, so we had these late deadlines, and so police beat was partly how I got trained. But also, I remember to this day a conversation I had. This was sort of toward the end of my freshman year, and you know, at that point anyway, that was when you needed to declare your major. And as I say, there was no journalism program. I was an English major and history minor, and one main reason was that our editor-in-chief at that point, the Tennessean, Mr. John Siegenthaler. Now, you'll see Mr. Siegenthaler's name in many places prominently, as we should, on this campus. And he was our editor, and I remember talking to him one evening after deadline. I said, you know, I'm down here in school, and I need to declare a major. And I said, so what do you think? And he said, well, you know, his answer was, we're going to teach you how to write. Whether they ever did, you know, was a whole other meeting. But he says, we're going to teach you how to write, so why don't you learn something else? Why don't you learn something else? And this is what led me to English and to history and to political science. He said, because what will be the best of all in terms of anybody's training is to learn how people work and how people are. Learn about people and humanity. Economics would have served as well, of course. I chose English and history and political science. And that made all the difference in the world to me, because that helped me. All of that, not just political science, but the other subjects. Literature, you know, learning about the human heart and how people behave. Together with being trained at that morning newspaper and those long hours into the evening, nights and weekends, in fact, did help me know. And so I just mentioned that because of the topic that we have here this afternoon and that Philip has with a broader lecture series about rhetoric in contemporary society. My topic is really about the uses of rhetoric in politics, in how we, in public affairs, how do we transact our business in terms of living in a democratic society. And more specifically, how it plays out and how we have observed it work in terms of two important processes in our society. One is in politics in the sense of political campaigns. How do candidates compete successfully? How do candidates win? And why maybe some others don't? But also in terms of public administration, executive leadership in our government. Because the truth is, both of those activities, political campaigns, how candidates compete and win, and how once candidates are in office, how do they function successfully when they are successful. Now, the other preliminary I want to raise is just to make sure everybody's got two pieces of paper. And by the way, I like, can you still hear me right over there? I like to walk around, and hope you don't mind. And I like to do this for two reasons. So when you're tethered to the lectern up here on the podium, it took me forever to get those terms straight. But if you're tethered by a wire, right, if I'm over here, it may be harder for you to hear me. That's one reason. Pretty good, right? That's fine. The other is that, you know, we'll see how this goes, and if this doesn't work out, I can just go on out that door. You know, I love that part. But anyway, I don't think we're going to have to do that today. You can let me know. But the two pieces of paper, one is just called speech writing, and I wanted you to see this. It's not for me to brag or be boastful about who in our shop at the strategy group we have worked for, although we're very proud of each and every one of these clients, these institutions, these corporations. We're very proud. But more so, it's to just demonstrate, if nothing else, that whatever your field, whatever department your major is in, that my experience, and I think the experience of a lot of people I know, has been that whatever your department or field, that there are lots of applications for that in your life. You know, it's, I think Mr. Siegenthaler's advice was very sound. You know, we'll teach you how to write here at this newspaper. And I was there for 10 years total. We'll come back to that. But to know, to be grounded in whether your major is in mathematics or economics or agriculture or any of these important fields, you will likely have more possibilities in terms of career as you move along in your life than you think you will. And that was really a revelation to me. I mean, I am not a doctor of anything, but I've had some experiences that have helped me appreciate that fact. You know, that and not just the subjects you learn, with all respects to the faculty members here, but your interrelationships and how you are educated by your peers. You know, that happens, right? So, when I graduated, if you'd shown me this piece of paper, I would have said, well, you're crazy. I don't know where all that's going to come from. But the amazing thing is how one thing leads to another, how one relationship can lead you to others. Philip mentioned some of the projects in Middle Tennessee that we have been fortunate to work on. And that has been particularly true in that realm for me, and it will be true for you in one way or another in your life. The first big project that we were privileged to work on was the Country Music Hall of Fame and Museum in Nashville. And that was turned out to be very successful. It was this big, wonderful, multi-part, complicated project that had to do with design of a new museum facility, a tourist destination. Had more than 1 million visitors the past 2 years, I'm proud to say. But also the whole notion of managing that all together, helping the CEO be able to bring that off. That led to the sequence of this was very interesting. That led to an opportunity to work on what turned out to be the Frist Center for the Visual Arts in downtown Nashville. I remember the day I got a phone call from President Jim Walker at MTSU, and he said that Governor Ned McWhorter had just called him, and they had discussed how MTSU was receiving a bequest from somebody that Philip mentioned, the Tennessee Miller Coliseum. Who's familiar with that here in town? Good. Well, Mr. Miller, there were people who remembered Mr. Miller, but not in connection with the university. Well, it turns out he made a fortune being one of the contractors that built the Trans-Alaska pipeline. That's all he ever did. And was a very successful businessman. But over the years, he had sort of lost a connection, or I should say the university had lost a connection with him. But when he got into the profitable sort of end of his career, he hadn't lost the connection, and he remembered what had happened here. And so in his will, he left, I think it was $15 million. And that became, so Dr. Walker, grabbed that opportunity, assembled a planning committee, and the Miller Coliseum is there. Today, that led for us to the what became the Skirmerhorn Symphony Center in downtown Nashville, and on and on. I don't want to dwell on that, but my point is that what you're learning and who you're meeting, and I don't mean just faculty members, but your peers here will be very important. And to me, that's a hopeful idea, and it's something to look forward to. The other handout, and I actually want to talk through this. 16 commandments. Does anybody not have that? Okay, good. This is this actually started as 12 commandments, as sometimes they do, but this has been developed over some period of time, and it's now 16. And I'll come back to that in a few minutes. Now, so let's consider these two applications of rhetoric and how that is important in our society. In political campaigns that are very important in our society, and also in the administration of government after candidates win. And the fact is they both have some very important functions in common. For both applications, what comes first is message. You can call it wordsmithing or whatever, but the message always comes first. What is it that candidate, and just visualize a campaign, and not necessarily a presidential campaign. It's hard for us not to think about that right now, but think of whatever city you come from, who has run for mayor, who has run for United States Senate. Maybe you know somebody who's run for the city council. I'm the only Nashvillean, by the way, whose mother and father were elected to the city council. That's where I am. I'm pretty sure of that. My dad was on the first metropolitan. Who's from Nashville? Who votes in that? Okay. So we've had our metropolitan form of government since 1963. And my dad was on the first council before that term ended. He died. He was 44 years old. He died early. And my mom was a metro school teacher and had been in all of his campaigns, of course, and friends prevailed on her to run. There was no special appointment or anything. He was so close to the election, there would be a special election a little bit further up in the fall. And she ran and beat five guys without a runoff. Beat them fair and square. So I just say that, tell you that little story, because that's kind of where I come from. I haven't been in public office, but being around the city hall, you know, watching how that happens, how elected officials got to be there in the first place and to transact city business, and how the, you know, those decisions got made with respect to persuading, as we say, 50% of the people plus one, that your idea is on this proposal or that is the right one. And it happens in a thousand ways, right? So it's not just people in presidential elections that get all the ink and the attention. It's every other political office. And for those that are successful, what I've learned is that the message comes first, that the thought process is, what is it you're trying to say to whom and how and when? It's not the other way around. So what is it that you want in this first instance, voters, news media, people who can help project your message, what is it that you want them to know about you? And that's a very important process. And how, you know, not everybody wins, not everybody's supposed to win, but this is how candidates help voters make a choice. And so usually by the end of a campaign period, the candidate who has been most successful at that formulation, you know, whatever you're for or against, determining what is it that I want whom to know about me, the ones who are the most successful with that thought process, you know, on the ground, on the street, as we say, are the ones typically that win. Once the, you know, the public official has been elected and is in office, it's actually a similar thought process. When I was, I guess the next phase of my own career where I learned about how this works successfully or not was when I was posted in Washington for the Tennessean newspaper. Now, I was just out of graduate school at that point. And this is before the Tennessean was a Gannett newspaper, okay? Everybody's cool with that. I mean, now this is a chain-owned newspaper now, part of the USA Today network, as they say. But this is before that point, and the Tennessean was an independently, locally owned by the Evans family of Middle Tennessee newspaper. And we had a, I was very fortunate in that the correspondent who was posted in Washington for the Tennessean, her name was Elaine Shannon, got a job with Newsweek magazine. And it created, you know, good for Elaine, right? But it created this vacancy right about the time I was in graduate school and talked to my boss in Nashville. And what they decided to do was to begin sending kind of a rotation of reporters up there. I could only be there for the fall quarter because the rest of my program at Northwestern, the Medill School of Journalism, would take me to Evanston, north of Chicago, in January. But I had this period of 5 or 6 months. So I got to go be the Washington correspondent for the Tennessean. I'm just telling that because I remember telling people in D.C. that I would meet, that actually I was chief of the Washington Bureau. It was just me. I think I believe that might be a way to meet girls, you know. It didn't work out for that. Anyway, so it was just me. In fact, we shared an office suite on Pennsylvania Avenue with two other regional newspapers. But the experience was priceless. And I was able to, you know, your main job in that role was to cover your state delegation to Congress, the senators and the House members. And I began to be able to observe other elected officials other than those in City Hall. you know, in Murfreesboro City Hall government as well as Nashville City government. And this whole theory about message comes first, I began to see how that works in real life. And so at the time we had serving in the U.S. Senate from Tennessee was Senator Howard Baker, Senator Bill Brock, both Republicans. Senator Brock was succeeded next election by Jim Sasser, U.S. Senator, served three terms and became a U.S. ambassador to China later. But all these people were very excellent communicators, some better than others, but they would typically employ that formulation. You know, what is the message? What am I trying to say? To whom? How and when? And both as candidates and as elected officials. Now, and this is where we began to get a sense of the different ways of communicating. This speech writing thing is only one application, right? I mean, we start maybe as a reporter, correspondent for a newspaper, and we see candidates and public officials do these things, and how some do it better than others. And if you apply that then to let's take some specific examples. Senator Howard Baker, very successful national figure. He was the U.S. winning his seat in the U.S. Senate was the first election he ever won. I mean, he was a lawyer in Knoxville. He's gone now, but he was a lawyer in Knoxville in the beginning. He grew up in Scott County up in East Tennessee. He's a lawyer in his hometown, also in Knoxville. And Senator Baker was able to put together a new kind of statewide political coalition. He was from East Tennessee, and Middle Tennessee was predominantly, almost totally Democratic at the time, Baker a Republican, coalition with people in I would say extreme West Tennessee, in Memphis and Shelby County. Now, a lot of these people, there were actually 10 married couples who were very, we would think of them now as moderate, progressive Republicans. They were, they'd all been involved in the Eisenhower campaign way back in the early 50s. Most of the men were lawyers, later judges, and they got to know Senator Baker. And so they brought together very effectively and now very famously this East-West thing that helped Baker do very well in the election of 1964. It became a vehicle, the coalition did, for Baker's message to people all across the state. It was a message of progressivism and so forth, and people were now able to hear him. We keep talking about the Tennessean newspaper. This coalition got Baker on the radar of the Tennessean, which was a predominantly Democrat, forget predominantly, it was a Democrat newspaper in the editorial, you know, slant. And Baker lost that election, but not by very much, about 25,000 votes in a statewide race in Tennessee. That was significant, and it was encouraging to him. He ran again in 1966, and which is when he won. And Baker served this long time, a brilliant, you know, well-known career in the United States Senate. And in 19, and because his message so impressed the editorial staff of the Tennessean for the first time ever endorsed a Republican for the United States Senate. But it all got back to what Baker had to say and how effectively he was saying it. Now, the country at large got to know Baker, if we jump ahead about 6 years, in the Watergate scandal. Baker was not involved in the scandal, but he was prominently, getting more seniority in the Senate. And so when President Nixon got into all that controversy, the Senate established the Select Committee on Presidential Campaigns. Baker, the Senate was controlled by the Democrats at that time, and so the chairman of the investigating committee was Senator Sam Ervin, Democrat, and Senator Baker became the vice chairman of the committee. And now we can talk all day about that sometime, but and not today, but that projected Baker to a national audience as never before in his career. And the message that to this day you will hear quoted from Senator Howard Baker was, what did the president know and when did he know it? What did the president know and when did he know it? And that became a big turning point, because it was clear then that possibly even the president himself, but certainly his senior staff at the White House, knew more than they were telling at this very early pivotal point about the break-in at the Democratic National Headquarters and so forth. And that quote is just, to me, has always been a good example about how the message, words matter, words count. And don't let anybody tell you they don't, because they are very effective and persuasive. And in the Baker case to this day, certainly in Tennessee, but across the country, is remembered for that reason. Baker had a young legislative assistant, another lawyer from East Tennessee named Lamar Alexander. He was on his staff. And it is Alexander who hired me away from the Tennessean in 1977 to be his speechwriter and to be involved, as Philip read from the bio. The sort of next phase of my career was with Alexander. In the first place, his campaign for governor in 1978. He'd run in 1974 and lost to Governor Ray Blanton. There's a whole book about that, by the way, if you want to read that sometime. But then in 1977, Alexander determined he would try it again. I like to say that Alexander lost at first, but when he met me, he's always won. Don't tell him I said that, okay? The point here, seriously, is that I observed very quickly, as most people have who've known those two politicians, that Alexander was heavily and very positively influenced by his boss, Senator Baker. When we started the 78 campaign, what would turn into the 78 election campaign, in the summer of 77, we talked about speeches and message and how the message comes first, and some of the early elements that he wanted to incorporate into his campaign, which he hoped would be successful. And he said to me, I remember it like it was this morning, Lamar Alexander, not yet in office, said, okay, when it comes to speeches, he said to me, here's what we're going to do. We're going to work like it worked for me and Senator Baker. He says, Senator Baker told me, Alexander, that when it comes to speech writing, you can write whatever you want to write, as long as I get to say whatever I want to say. And yeah, now that sounds funny, but it worked. I mean, it certainly worked for Alexander and Baker, and I think it worked pretty well for Alexander, because he himself, like Baker before him, was a pretty good wordsmith. I mean, he's a writer. He's written books. He has a way with words. But the fact is that someone running for statewide office, as in that situation, or someone serving as governor, as he did after he won that election the next year, are very busy people. I mean, they need help. They need help with some of the messages. I mean, not every you think of the big State of the State address that's on TV, or you think about the commencement address at MTSU, but and those are important, and those have to be crafted and put together in the way that he wants his message to come forward. But also, there are hundreds of things that have to be seen to. You know, there are a lot of other commencement addresses. There are TV appearances. Opportunities to present a message from the administration now, you know, to other audiences in the legislature, to parent organizations all across the state. And so somebody like that needs help. And I just say that as another encouragement. You know, the things that you learn, whatever your major, while you're here, you know, can have applications in ways that you don't expect, as it did for me. Let's just take I want to stop very shortly so we can have a conversation. I want to hear what you want to ask and what you have to say. But let me go through the 16 commandments. This really started as the 12 commandments. I thought that was kind of cool. You know, but the as you can see, the list grew. It was, by the way, you know the rule about cell phones? If you're in a public setting, if your phone rings, Dr. Val, you may have told me this, but if the phone rings of the person sitting next to you the third time, you get to answer it. Yeah, that's fine. So just remember that. Okay, I'm not going to go through all 16. Don't worry. You know, breathe out. But I am going to hit just a few highlights that have been important to me. Now, this is the subhead there is important for speechwriters. I mean, this is not commandments for everybody. But if you find yourself in a situation, and I think you will more than you might expect, where you're helping somebody craft a message. It may be in an office setting. Maybe you're helping the boss at, you know, State Farm or someplace get ready for a presentation, you know, to employees or shareholders or the community or the Chamber of Commerce. Well, this all applies, right? It all applies in one way or another. So it's not just I know I've been talking a lot about politics and politicians, but this applies to a lot of different kind of people. Let's just start. It's not about you. You know, I mean, we're very high on ourselves as writers. Now, not that you don't get anxious or you get butterflies when you say, oh, my God, I've got to figure out that five-minute presentation for the boss, you know, where she's going to go to the Chamber of Commerce next week. Okay, but it's not about you. It's about that principal, right? It's about the boss. And as you'll see down through here, let me just skip around some. Know thy boss's voice. Know the voice. Now, knowing the voice doesn't mean I've heard you, or I know how you speak. I know your syntax. It's sort of projecting into that person's preparation your knowledge of how the person sounds and how. I mean, everybody in the room here has a different way of talking, particularly if you're in front of two or more people. I mean, it's a function of human nature and how we prepare. It's not about you. It's about that person. So you have to subsume. You know, you have to bury yourself into the role of being helpful to that person in his or her voice. That's what that means. I mentioned words matter. I mean, words matter so much. In our national politics currently, there gets to be disagreement about what do certain words mean, what was intended. Words matter. And I have been blessed, and I'll say it here, to been able to work for the folks that I've worked for on the other piece of paper. I mean, and again, not just politicians, but CEOs and university presidents and so forth, where you know, they have very important work to do. They don't have unlimited time to do it, and to be able to help a person like that is a great opportunity. Be in the loop, you know, get in the schedule. You're sort of forcing yourself onto the organization, but that's the job you've been given to do. Know the audience. I knew a little bit about you guys, you know, coming in. When I parked over across the street, Philip, did I mention this to you? So I was told to park across the street and then go in the student services and see the nice lady who will give me the parking thing, you know, the hangar. And so she was very nice. And so I'm saying, well, here's who I am, and I'm going to go over here and be a speaker this afternoon. And she said, oh, yeah, well, I think they had 600 people in there today. And I thought, well, that's pretty good. And then she said, but they all left. Clearly, they didn't all leave. But know thy introducer. Let me just hit that one. Depending on the situation, the introducer, now that's somebody you got to meet. I mean, you got to like talk to that man or woman. My favorite example was that in 1983, there was an important anniversary celebration in the city of Oak Ridge. Anybody here from Anderson County, Oak Ridge? Well, they're all good people, I'll tell you that. Oak Ridge is the famous story that had been the secret city involved in the site, one of the sites in the Manhattan Project, where the bomb was developed, along with three or four other cities around the country. And so it was secret, you know, it was a national secret. And then the point came where it became public. I mean, the bomb was dropped and so forth. And so later there was, I may have the year wrong here, but could have been 84, but it was like the 40th anniversary of the city of Oak Ridge, the atomic city. Well, so Governor Alexander was invited to come speak and, you know, to the occasion. And so we worked on that and went over, took a helicopter to Oak Ridge, which is a great way to get to Oak Ridge, by the way. So we got out and went to the event was at the Atomic Energy Museum. In Oak Ridge. Great turnout. Full house of people. Well, the person that somebody had asked to introduce Governor Alexander was a good friend of his, as an older gentleman who turns out, a great guy, but turns out he was very nervous and he'd never been asked to do this before. And so I'm sitting, you know, back out in the crowd and they're up on the dais. And this fella gets up to introduce the governor of Tennessee. And he talks, and he talks, and he talks. Governor's remarks were about 8 minutes. This guy went on for 22 minutes. I remember it like it was last night, okay, 22 minutes. So, you know, hey, get to know the introducer. That's all number six means there. And let him know, you know, hey, don't talk 22 minutes. Keep it simple. It's not a term paper you're writing. You're writing a message to communicate between one person and another person or with a group of people. Keep it short. The acronym KISS, K-I-S-S, keep it simple. So I just have for the second S, I say keep it short because short is always better than long. And it's about the ear, not the eye. You know, sometimes in our, how many have worked with a slide deck, you know, the PowerPoint to make a report or a presentation? A lot of us have. And, that's pretty cool technology. And I don't, and it gets better all the time, right? You'll notice I didn't bring any because I don't like it too much, personally. It gets in the way. A good reason to use it in a conference room situation is when you project something on the wall, particularly with people you hadn't met before, it gives you a common spot to focus and not everybody is, you know, necessarily talking to other people. And it's a way of discharging some of that energy, but it can also be a distraction. And if they're not organized well, if they're not well put together, and by the way, each slide ought to be put together in this formulation we talked about. I mean, what are you trying to communicate to whom and how? Paint pictures and tell stories. One of the people who most influenced now Senator Alexander in his career was the writer Alex Haley. Now, who can tell me who Alex Haley was? Yes, ma'am. Indeed, he did. Mr. Haley wrote the autobiography of Malcolm X, which I read when I was a student at this university. He wrote Roots, when it was television. And you got one more. Roots became a blockbuster TV miniseries, you know, when it came out. Anyway, just a very influential writer, important writer. And he and Alexander got to know each other back in the 70s. And Senator Alexander told me just the other day, he said, you know, I was talking to him about a chapter in a new book that I'm writing. And he said, you know, this reminds me, Keel, of something Alex Haley told me. He said, you know, when you're making a talk, you should, we were talking about how to begin this chapter. You know, I was looking for suggestions from other writers. And he said, it's like when you're making a speech. He said, don't tell people, I'm going to make a speech to you. Mr. Haley said, much better is to say, I want to tell you a story. Now, you can probably feel inside yourself when I said that. I mean, you want to hear a story. Everybody wants to hear a story. So telling stories is always much better than making speeches, and that's important for each of us, and it's important for anybody later down the line we might be helping with. What's the headline? I mean, that may seem a little odd, but that's, you know, not everybody's talk is going to be covered by the newspaper or TV or radio, but visualizing how it might is actually a good writerly technique to know, well, what is the takeaway? What am I trying to say to you? And what is that headline? Because if I'm confused on that, I must not be surprised if whatever headline comes out, because it might be way off the money. So it takes preparation, and this is true in our public rhetoric. It's true. I say this a lot, but whether you're speaking, you know, to someone else in your community, or you're helping somebody else address 50,000 people, it's still true. What is the headline that I desire to come out of this? Humor is really something that most people who help other folks with presentations learn the hard way. Humor is funny unless it's not. Political humor is like the riskiest of all. We can talk a bit more about that if you want to. Props and notes should help, not hurt. President Obama, he doesn't need me to say this, but I was an excellent communicator. The man can make a great speech. He came in for a little ribbon, you know, along the way when he started using very early the teleprompters. I always have to remember how that's spelled. But anyway, and the teleprompter is great technology. But even with that, you can get distracted as the speakers, and to the point where it hurts and doesn't help. Now that's a big, spectacular example. It happens a lot more frequently in terms of a lot of our speech writing clients. We'll say, you know, one of the things we have to establish early with that client is what do you want with you, you know, when you're at the lectern. And what I dread hearing is when that person says, well, I want to have a full text, you know. I mean, I love to write full text, right? But I don't want to hear that speaker want to use a full text, because if I'm going to read to you, then what's the first thing happening? I mean, I'm losing eye contact with everybody. And so other clients will say, well, no, I like to use note cards. You know, have note cards, stick in my pocket, come up. Senator Al Gore was a good one with note cards. I mean, President Reagan used note cards very effectively. And so there's a big gamut. And finally, do the mic check. Okay, it's not good when you've got all this preparation, and you know the governor is stepping up into the well of the state legislature to make the 29.5 minutes state of the state speech, and nobody did the mic check, and it's going out to TV audiences all over the state, and so at some early point, people learned to do the mic check. That's a crazy example, I know, but it works. it's very helpful. I should say it happens, whether it's a Rotary Club speech or, you know, wherever your rhetoric is going to be put to use. We can't assume that all the technology is working, so it's a very simple rule. Well, tell you what, let me stop there. I mean, let's just take, we got a few minutes left. I can go on for hours, and I've been known to. But who has a comment or a question or an experience to share? Yes, sir.
So where are you from?
I'm from here, Murfreesboro.
Good.
I originally grew up in Lebanon. I just kind of had just a question. You know, you said mic check, but I don't think I heard your. I think it was your natural voice the whole time. I don't think I heard your mic. Was it on?
It may be a mic for the.
Is it a mic?
Is it a PA system mic?
Okay. I saw the mic and I was expecting the whole time to hear some sort of thing come through this, but I guess I'm just.
That's a great question.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I know it's like the only one you skipped over, but what does move people, not paper mean?
Say again.
What does move people, not paper mean?
Seventh.
Your seventh.
Yes. That one is, you're speaking usually in our rhetoric to get a response, to get action, for example, to get understanding, of course. And if we get too busied up, this actually is a point about preparation, you know. If we get too over-prepared, so to speak, working on that text, you know, trying to get that all right, then we're going to lose eye contact, for one thing. We're going to lose every speech ought to be a one-on-one communication. Now, you just multiply that times ever how many people are in the room. But you're talking to one person. What was the great Mark Twain quote? He says, the only people who should use the royal we are either kings, editors, or people with tapeworms. And I like to remember that because you're always, and this is particularly true with radio. It's also true for TV. But if you're on the radio talking, you know how many people are out there. But what you want to do is visualize speaking to your sister, you know, one-on-one communication. And not that I'm making a big, you know, pompous speech to 1,000 people through that microphone, because that'll trip you up every time. I used to do an editorial commentary on TV in Nashville. Channel 4, the NBC affiliate, they had at the end of the scene at 6, it was the best part of the scene at 6, it really was. So one night a week, I got to do this, and I hadn't done that before, and the first couple of, what saved me, it was taped, okay, so they could go back and redo it. But I talked to a coach, actually, who helped me be ready to know how to do this, and she really helped me. And one of the very early suggestions was to not focus on that camera lens, but visualize my grandmother sitting on the other side of the lens, and that would be true, you know, in a technical sense. I mean, she'd be in her home watching the TV, and you know, you can almost tell if somebody is not doing it that way who's on your screen. That, I mean, you can almost tell that their eyes are focused on the camera and not all of us who are out in their audience. So that's what this is trying to get to. You know, it's about people, not your prep. There were two more. I'm sorry. You and then you.
Oh, I was just going to make a joke that I thought he was going to apologize for his phone ringing.
Yeah.
Well, somebody call him and I'll show you how it works.
No.
And I'm sorry.
If you had to pick like a speech that you were like, you think moved the most people or that you were the most proud of, which one would it be?
You mean one that I've written? I think it was the, in 1983, Governor Alexander, I was on his staff, proposed a real sweeping education reform program. It was called the Better Schools Program. It involved incentive pay for teachers. It became very controversial. The career ladder, you know, which still exists in some respect. And he had an opportunity to go speak. And who opposed that the most were the teacher unions, the teacher associations, the National Education Association and the AFT, the American Federation for Teachers. The AFT had a convention in Los Angeles. And their leadership were kind of warming up to this concept, very controversial here. And he was invited to come give a keynote speech to the AFT annual meeting in Los Angeles. And that speech, to this day, it kind of moves me, you know, that because it was not necessarily a friendly audience, but at the end they gave him a standing ovation. I mean, this Republican guy, you know, from Tennessee, who would have thought? But there are a lot of good examples. I appreciate that question. Should we stop?
I think we're out of time. Keel, thank you so much for your time.